Are you aware of the effects of race, of institutional racism in your area? And if so, what have you done to stop the issues of institutional racism? Yes, anyway, yes.
When you say area, what exactly are you referring to?
I guess the students mean St. Cloud.
Oh, yes.
Well, White Cloud, whatever you want to call it.
St. Cloud State University.
Well, St. Cloud State.
It's a systemic place of racism. This place reeks, stinks of racism. What we have done about it in the last 21 years I've been here is speak out against it. The only thing is, when you speak out, all right, when you stand up, you can't sit down anymore. No. I've gotten a lot of death threats over the years. You know, neo-Nazis, Nazis, hate mail. When I say St. Cloud State is a sick place, the university, as well as the community, believe me. Now, I saw some of you out there protesting about the young brother that died. Protesting is one thing. Now, take it to the next level. Just don't go out there and just, you know, no justice, no peace and all that. Yeah, okay, that's fine and good. Okay, now what are you going to do? How can you top what you did today? All right? If some of you are become defensive about what is happening, that means you don't know your history. You know, the clip that they were showing is very good. Outstanding clip. You know, the agony. Because my students, when I talk to them about race, they think black people, our history started with slavery. He said, no. It was the Europeans who were living in caves. All right? We had kingdoms in Africa, dynasties in Asia, throughout the world. It was the Europeans actually were, you know, and when they came out of the caves, they started stealing other cultures. You know? Because you have a question down there, a multicultural down the line somewhere. Let me get into that. That's okay. All I got
to
say.
Anyone else would like to respond to question number one?
I want to address question number one to what we are reacting to presently, and that is Trayvon Martin case.
Yes.
I have written a letter, and I'm going to submit it to the media, and I want to share with you and then deal with one institution, particularly the criminal justice system, and that is the biggest control mechanism, the one of the biggest perpetrators of racism today. Here we are at the university. I think it's very important that we begin to analyze what's happening so we can fully understand the impact, so we can understand why the Trayvon Martin case is kind of front and center at this point. So this is the letter I'm going to submit for a publication, and I'll read part of it. It has to do with the analysis. The Trayvon Martin case has sparked the mobilization of millions who are morally outraged because Trayvon symbolized the targets and victims of the deeply racialized criminal justice system. This case is socially and politically explosive. To understand the social and political dynamics of this case, we have to focus on the centrality of race in the criminal justice system. Now, Americans profess to believe that the rule of law should be applied equally to all citizens regardless of racial status. Yet, it is beyond dispute that the criminal so-called justice system functions from start to finish in a racially biased way. I mean, from the definition of crimes, from investigation to arrest, to charging, to conviction, and to sentencing, from start to finish. The basic facts of the case are these. There was a deadly encounter between George Zimmerman, an armed white man who, while patrolling his neighborhood, stalked Trayvon Martin, an unarmed black teenager who was simply walking home, minding his own business. Now, during an altercation, Zimmerman shot Martin dead. When the police arrived, Zimmerman claimed that he was attacked by Trayvon. And in self-defense, he shot and killed Trayvon.
Zimmerman was not held or charged, and the incident was not fully investigated. Legal officials cited Florida's Stand Your Ground law as justification for Zimmerman's release. Now, Minnesota Republicans attempted to pass similar legislation in this state, right? It was vetoed by Governor Mark Dayton. They wanted to stand, they just kind of stand your ground. You're walking around with a concealed weapon. If you feel threatened, then pull out your gun and pop a cap on somebody, right? Right here in Minnesota. Okay. But fortunately, Governor Dayton vetoed that bill by the Republicans. Now, social scientists and criminologists have determined through statistical analysis that in the majority of violent black versus white encounters, blacks are presumed to be the aggressor. Zimmerman's account of what transpired and the casual manner in which the case was initially handled fit nicely the racial narrative of roles and symbols of blacks and whites. In the general crime storyline, the roles of blacks and whites are already prescribed. The white character is the good hero, and the black character is the violent criminal. Now you adapt this role, this script, to the Trayvon Martin case, this is what you get, okay? The racial scenario is this. Zimmerman is portrayed as a civic-minded white man who protects his community against black criminals to keep it safe. But Trayvon Martin represents a violent black thug who poses a threat to public safety. Every black male, young and old, is stigmatized as a potential or actual threat or menace to society.
That's right. That's right.
The vast majority of black men have had a negative encounter with the criminal justice system, including Martin Luther King. One of the many personal encounters with the police department happened to me in St. Cloud. Here's the case, my case. What are the situations right in this community? Well, on Monday, July 9th, 2007, at about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I was walking home from my office at St. Cloud State University. I was stopped on the sidewalk by two police officers who were in separate cars. One officer got out of the car, looked at me, looked at my little bag I was carrying, right? And this police officer perceived me as a purse, and me as a purse snatcher. I mean, this is a broad daylight, right off of, you know, Fifth Avenue and all. Okay, so the fact that I, a university professor and senior citizen, was stopped on a busy street in mid-afternoon and publicly humiliated by police officers because they perceived me as a suspected purse thief indicates the high level of anti-black police profiling in the city of St. Cloud. I filed a formal complaint, but it was disdainfully dismissed, and I did not even get an apology. Folks, let me show you what happened, all right? I've been in the struggle for decades and decades. I am not gonna let that kind of disrespect go unanswered. So what did I do? And what should you do? First, you wanna document the incident. That's what I did. I wrote down described the incident that occurred and sent the letter to the chief of police, the mayor, all the members of the city council, and many other community members, right? And I also contacted our elected officials at the state level, right? Now, we had a lot of problems here in St. Cloud, and because police is notorious for harassing and intimidating black folks. When I moved here in 1989, there were very few blacks. And then after a couple of years, there was a wave of Somalis. This whole community, St. Cloud, St. Cloud, city of St. Cloud, went into defense mode. And these white citizens saw black people as representing an invasion, right? A threat, you know, gangsters coming in, thugs and all. And so they put all the police on high alert, and they went all on control for black folks, okay? And there were all kinds of encounters and incidents, and we had community meetings to deal with the high level of police harassment in this city. As I walked to my office, I noticed that cars were being pulled over, and virtually every car that I saw pulled over had a black man and a white woman in that car, right? I had students, they were driving down, there were three students in the car, right? Two young white women and a black male student, right down the division. And so the white female was driving, and then all of a sudden there was a police bearer, lights flashing for her to pull over. And so she said to her other passenger, "I wonder why we've been pulled over. We're not speeding or anything." And so the black guy in the back, he said, "I know why they pulled it over, because I'm in this car, right?" And she was naive. She didn't believe that and all that sort of thing, right? So the police officer stopped her, and then they asked the driver for a license and all that. And then they went, and here's the black passenger in the back seat, told him to produce some ID, and went and interrogated and focused all on him and interrogated him. I mean, this is just two examples about what's going on.
Yes,
now,
yes.
Behind all of that harassment, the state government pretend that they were addressing some racial profile. So I got a whole stack of posters, and I was gonna contribute, if you think you're racially profiled, here's what you should do. So this is from the state of Minnesota, and I'll read part of it. It says, "The police should never stop your car because of the color of your skin," right? "The color of your skin, your race, ethnicity, or national origin, your profile is not reason alone for you to be stopped or searched by a police officer. And if that happens, look, they have a toll-free number, 1-800-657-3787. Whoa, I think I've been racially profiled. Let me go. Hey, call it up." So I called up the Attorney General's office, and what do I get on the other end? A lot of static. It's like, what are you calling here for, right? When I made the call, I identified myself and I stated my purpose for the call, right? And so I got so much static from the person on the other, from this guy on the other end. I said, "Well, who are you?" I said, "Can you identify yourself?" He's a public employee. He wanted to remain anonymous. He didn't even want to give me his name, right? So again, then I asked, "I want to speak to your supervisor, right?" And he said the supervisor was around, and I said, "Well, I will leave a message for your supervisor to call me back, right?" So anyway, I did get a call from the supervisor. Supervisor came, called me up, and he was very professional and polite, right? And explained to me what this number, it says, "Call, report racial profiling, contact the office of the Minnesota Attorney General," right? So I called, so he said that this office really doesn't handle those kinds of cases. He said, this is like, in other words, he didn't say use these words. He said, this is pretty much a joke. They had the Republicans and Democrats, and they already went up in the legislature in St. Paul, going back and forth and back and forth, and then they found some little pacification language and put it out there. But we're not going to move on it, right? We'll put the verbiage out there, but we're not going to move on it.
Right.
So, I'm not going to let it go there. Hey, this is a throwdown thing, so I'm taking it to the next level. I'm not going to talk to the subordinates in the Attorney General's office. Mm-hmm. I'm going to go right to the Attorney General, Lori Swanson. All right. So I'm typing out. I sent my letter to Lori, the Attorney General, John. Here's what she wrote. Okay. And I have already touched bases. I sent my complaint to the mayor, to the police chief, to the council members, and all. I'm touching all bases. Right now, I'm taking it to the state level. Well, I'll read part of this. This is official letter.
Yeah, and then we have to move on to the next question.
Oh, okay. I know I'm taking around a lot of time, but I want to give them some feet for thought. But
yes, hey, yes.
Let me bring it to a quick close in. All right. It was nothing about dismissal. She starts off, and this gives you an idea. It says, number one, you should go someplace else if you want a racial profiling. And this is the general story in terms of black folks and other communities of color when he tried to go and have those rights respected if they're dismissed. Because that's not the intent in the first place. So in terms of one institution that practices institutionalized racism, that institution of the criminal justice system and the police department is one of the main obstacles and instruments of oppression for black folks, not only in the city of St. Cloud, but throughout. The criminal justice system is the most oppressive, the largest, and most effective control mechanism that determines the future of, and it's responsible for weakening, in a serious way, the black community.
Okay, that was very powerful. A lot of information. And I guess the message is that if you have issues that you're facing in this community, make sure you document it. Make sure you write things down. So when you do have an opportunity to maybe sue some of these people for discrimination or institutionalized racism, then you've got something on paper. And that's what I got out of that message. As we move forward, let's go to the second question. So we can move forward, or do anyone else want to answer this,
yes,
that
I
first
do.
Question?
No,
go ahead, we got.
That's right.
Go ahead on the end right there, Rachel on the end, one of my students. Go right ahead.
Okay, from a student's perspective, coming here, being indigenous, coming from a reservation, I had a hard time integrating in society here due to systematic oppression. You know, we were placed on reservations, segregated. It's basically a country within a country, and we're governed by 5,000 additional laws above and beyond any other U.S. citizen. So we have to answer to the federal government and the state government. My experience here at St. Cloud State University was not very welcoming. I've had people ask me, so do Indians just sit around on the reservation angry, fighting each other? I've been stereotyped and assumed that I'm a drunk, a drug dealer, or that I live off of casino money. The AIC, the American Indian Center, is where I found a place of belonging, but even there, St. Cloud State claims to be one of the most diverse colleges. Supposedly there's, 117 indigenous people that are supposed to be at the AIC. I'm still looking for them. That's how it's affected me being here on campus.
Right. Anyone else would like to respond to question number one? Yes, go. Go right there. Professor Charlene.
So you look on your schedule and there's actually 14 questions. We might only get through three, so
that's right.
Surprised.
That's right. We will fly through them. We'll add them all together.
So I'll just skip to number nine, first of all, really quickly. So it says, why did you agree to be on this panel? So number one,
yes,
is that even in the video, which was wonderful, there is racism across the board. It's not just African-American people finding these issues. So I hope that we realize that, number one. But the next thing is, of course, thinking about Trayvon Martin and thinking about what I taught my class, which I cover Asian-American studies, African-American studies, Native-American studies, and Chicano studies. And that in itself is an injustice on this campus because I cover each group in 6 weeks. So we do, and I see somebody else nodding his head, but Chicano studies, for example, in class number two, I say, okay, we just covered 1,500 years, now let's move forward. It's really horrible. It's 50 minutes you get to cover that much time. So that in itself is just something to think about in terms of if you're a student there and you're taking ethnic studies or anything else like that. Number one, enroll yourself in more classes. Don't accept the one required class because the things that you have to learn are so important and so deep and so broad, and you'll never get it in one class no matter how hard we try. So that's number one. In terms of institutional racism, this,
yes,
I think was pretty interesting. I moved here from California. I've been here for about a year and a half. And I moved here to do some contract work. Maybe it's 2 years now. It's been a while. But I moved here to do some contract work. And when I came here, my brother knew of the weather. and said, oh, you're not going to go to Minnesota in that car, which is my car. He said, I'll let you borrow my car. And I said, okay, fine. So he fixed it up the way we do, brothers and sisters, made sure the oil was changed and the tires were ready. I get here, and I swear, just driving into Minnesota, I get pulled over. I come over, and I'm in Minneapolis and living in that area. I get pulled over, and I'm thinking, wow, this is surreal. Finally, I come and I decide that this is the place I'm going to settle. I'm not too far from here, and I get pulled over a couple more times, and this is all within a year. The last time, I don't have the car anymore, and I'll tell you what the car was, but the last time I was driving from my, what I call little village, I'll just call it a little village, because all of these places to me are little villages around St. Cloud. So I'm driving from my little village into town because I have this job and I'm working with refugees here, teaching English, thinking that's the right thing to do. By the way, I have a background in international studies and law and all kinds of stuff, but none of that really matters. I'm driving in to do my job, and an officer pulls me over and says, is everything okay? And I looked at him, and he said, well, somebody called in and said that you were kind of weaving, and maybe you were just texting, but I think maybe I have a mistake. And I'm just so confused, and it's 9 o'clock in the morning. So again, this is probably about the fourth or fifth time I've been pulled over, but it was a Hummer. I know that every single time, if you've been pulled over, you know the look. Every single time I was pulled over, they looked at me and they were so surprised to see me. I knew they expected somebody else. And I thought, wow, where am I? So I decided then, at that point, I've been a community activist forever. For lots of other reasons, and I decided at that time I was going to see about a job here on campus to try and figure out what's going on. And so does it exist? It clearly exists. And I just mentioned the police, but there were other episodes, and I've had family members with me, and just incredible things. Yeah. Have you ever gone to a grocery store and been turned away and said, no, we will not sell to you? I have. So it's just amazing how people could do that and get away with it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. The first question. Are you aware of the effects of institutional racism?
Okay.
How does that have an effect on you here?
Well, institutional racism, and saying, first of all, I want to apologize to you. Talking about institutional racism, there are other issues I was fighting. That's why I'm late. We live racism. It's not only, it doesn't have to be in a fantastic way where somebody is killed, which of course we saw with Brother Martin. By the way, that can happen anywhere. Don't assume it's only a Florida thing.
Sure.
Anybody know, you see, one of the things that they've done to us, and I say us because we need all of us to take care of this, is they have erased our memory. Our memory is short. Smalley and Louise, two African-American senior citizens in the 1980s,